Hi friends, welcome to the David Dotan Show. And if you know me, you know me as a Forex gentleman. And this is episode one of the David Dotan Show because I have zero creativity to come up with another name. So what is this show about? Well, even though I'm a full-time trader, I have interest, curiosity, and knowledge about other things. Okay, so this podcast will be about, well, topics that I'm interested in. And in today's topic, we're going to talk about how COVID-19 has changed the working landscape. All right, you have Twitter, you have Google, you have Microsoft, IBM, and thousands of other companies telling their employees that they don't have to come back to work if they don't want to. And why is that? That's because productivity is there. Technology is there where people can now work from home. Skype stopped, 3 years ago, Skype was lagging and freezing, and same with Zoom. Now we deal with less pauses, less lagging. Technology is getting better, allowing us to work from home with less stress, less anxiety, and a lot more ease. So what has been happening right now? This situation has forced companies to push employees to work from home. What's happening is that companies are now realizing, hey, productivity has not gone down. Actually, if anything, in some cases, depending on the business, of course, productivity has gone up, which is why you're seeing Google, which is why you're seeing Microsoft, IBM, and other tech companies. They're in no rush to open up because the productivity is there. And in many cases, I don't know if you're like me, I'm a morning guy. Instead of getting to work at 9 a.m., I'm more productive from 6 to noon. Maybe you're a person that needs more sleep, but as long as you're getting your work done, what do I care what time you wake up? And maybe your productivity is gonna be better. So I'm gonna bring in my close friend, Marcos Mogyoros. Marcos, all right, is one of the leads of investment at Anthem Development. I think he's been there for 4 years and has done close to $1 billion in acquisition. Marcos knows what he's talking about. So let's bring Marcos in. We're going to ask him some questions here. All right. As promised, I'm bringing in friend of the show, Marcos Mogyoros, who's a good friend of mine as well. He's one of the leads of investment at Anthem Properties. And in 4 years there, he's done close to $1 billion in transactions. How you doing, Marcos?
Doing pretty well, man. How about yourself?
Thanks for having me. Of course, man, of course. I want your opinion on what's going on right now. Obviously, the landscape has changed. You know, we know that companies are more productive working from home, or at least more productive than expected. And I want to know what your opinion is on how that's going to affect the commercial real estate market, the warehousing market. I want to know your opinion on what's Anthem doing right now. How are you guys preparing?
Yeah, so I think you're spot on there. A lot of companies, including our own, were pretty impressed with how productive and how much we were able to get done during these times, being forced to work from home and all of that. And I think what that's going to do is, on one side of it, it's going to force companies to reevaluate their needs in terms of office space, how they're going to manage their employees and all of that. And then on the other side, you'll have changes, at least in the near term, of how when companies look for space. So with all these restrictions coming in, where before you may have X number of employees, say in 1,000 square feet of space, you may need more space to accommodate smaller number of employees. So there may be a neutral effect there, but it's really unknown right now. But to your point, a lot of companies are very impressed with how they're managing, how productive they are. And I know of several businesses that they're previously looking at expanding their space, and now they're reassessing that. And they may not need to do that, may save a lot of money in terms of leasing and overhead. So a lot of positives coming out of it, forced changes.
There's definitely a lot of expenses that come into having an office space, right? You're talking about leasing or owning a property. You're talking about maintenance, property taxes. You're talking about all these, you know, even cleaning the office, right?
Yeah.
Is an expense. Insurance. I feel like this is opening up executives' eyes to the power of having employees work from home. If you look at Google, if you look at Twitter, Microsoft, even IBM, they're telling employees, work from home. It's up to you if you want to come back.
Yeah, it all it comes down to two things. One is the corporate culture and the nature of the business. So some will be easier to work from home than others, but it also comes down to accountability and accountability in your employees. And I think a lot of people are taking this chance to say, hey, boss, look, I can do my work from home. I don't need to be coming in all the time. You get a lot more freedom. You know, you can walk your dog, all of that stuff. So I think we're going to see some significant changes moving forward and coming out of this.
Agreed, buddy. You know, one of the things that I've noticed is that at Forex Gentlemen, I have employees that work from other side of the world. I don't need anybody here at the office, right? That's not what I need. I need talented people no matter where they're from. And what I've noticed is that when you give people the opportunity to finish their responsibilities, they actually get it done in a timely manner, in a better manner. What I'm trying to say is this. For you, for example, you may need an extra hour of sleep in your morning than I do, right? But that extra hour increases productivity substantially. So if you give your employees the opportunity to dictate their schedule, as long as they're getting their work done, as long as their responsibilities are completed, I think that you're gonna see a tremendous increase in productivity, to be honest with you. And this is something that I've seen from hiring people over the last 5 years.
Yeah, I think you're right. And the other consideration too is, you know, not everyone lives walking distance from the office. So they're going to be worried about when things open up, taking transit to get to work and stuff like that. So they're going to be extra motivated to prove they could get the work done from home so they can avoid all that stuff, all that travel, all that interaction with other strangers and things like that.
So what do you think about commercial properties? Do you think that there's going to have to be rezoning? Do you think that over time companies will see less need for commercial space and more need for storing products and services?
Yeah, so there's different commercial asset classes, and there's a few things happening right now. You have this bifurcation of retail. So retail is one aspect, which has taken a massive hit from COVID. And there's this huge split between Class A retail product and Class B. Class B is falling by the wayside, whereas good shopping centers are still gonna do well, food, booze, drug anchored. So there's that. Then you look at industrial. That's all about supply chains. And that's been the single hottest, or one of the, that in multifamily rental, the hottest markets in at least North America, because there's just no space to store everything. People can do all their shopping online. What they need is the distribution. Mm-hmm. And industrial is just on fire absolutely everywhere.
Mm-hmm. And we're seeing in Vancouver.
You get into office. So in Canada, other than Alberta, office has been also on fire. So MTB, that's Montreal, Toronto, and Vancouver. Again, excluding Alberta, they have their own set of issues. I think in those other three major cities, we have a vacancy rate of under 4%, which is the lowest in the world and historically in Canada. So that's still hot. But again, with office, there'll be a lot of changes coming out of this. There'll be changes to how the space is tailored and then just the demand.
True, true. Another thing too that I thought about, and I know we spoke about this the other day, is potentially changes to new residential developments. So high rises and apartments right now, they usually have common spaces, whether it's a meeting or boardroom that you can rent out time slots, or whether it's a gym, or whether it's a bowling alley. All these buildings have all these little communal spaces and little selling points. Do you think, what I think, and I want your opinion on this, is that over time, more employees are gonna start working from home. This is gonna become very, very apparent as we also start to come out from this COVID situation. I think developers should be building shared office, communal office spaces at the bottom of their residential buildings, rather than just having one big boardroom to book a time slot. What do you think about that?
It's funny you bring that up, and I did not mention this when we spoke about it, but we're currently planning a huge tower in a suburb of Vancouver, and this is exactly one of the discussions we're talking about. It's more how you're programming that space, whereas, you know, the amenities, a lot of people don't use the gym or the pool as much. They're going to start needing more office space, work sharing, things like that. The other thing is that we're thinking about is things like touchless elevators. So you don't actually have to press anything that a bunch of strangers have been putting their hands all over.
Mm-hmm.
That might be a short-term thing, but I think that's where everything's going to go now. And yeah, there's going to be a lot more programmable office within residential buildings.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And I think you need to make that happen, buddy. I think you got to go. I think in the boardroom in front of the CEO, you got to say, this is happening. This is happening. Okay?
Yeah, no, I totally agree with you.
The confidence play.
The good thing about Anthem is that during these meetings, we have people from every department in the room. So there's leasing, there's marketing, there's development. So we do actually share these thoughts. And I think we'll be ahead of a lot of groups when we come out of it. But yeah, you're spot on with that. The other thing I think will change in office space is, you know, historically there's been this trend of open versus individual offices. I think that open concept office is gonna die in the next little bit, at least. You know, it's the very techie kind of thing. You share ideas, it's loud, engaging, and creative. Our office, every single person has their own individual office. So we're not concerned about going back there. You're not interacting with everyone. It's an enclosed space. I think that'll change as well.
Yeah, you know, I kind of like the mixture of two in office spaces.
Yep.
For me, as someone who's consistently filming, I find it a little bit awkward when I'm filming and I have like three people on the left and another table, another 10 people on the right.
Yep.
You know what I mean? It's a little, I like my space, but I think communal space is also important. But that also brings me to another question. How do you think like camaraderie, how do you think like teams working together, will that be affected with everything going on or will, you know, of course, when you're face to face with people, you work a little bit better, there's more flow, connections are a bit stronger, but I think technology is good enough now where it doesn't make that big of a difference.
It is. Again, it depends on the industry. I miss the face to face contact. My team works a door or two down from me, so I can just pop my head out and have a conversation about something we're working on. So that's tough. But meetings, you can have a lot of them through Zoom and mediums like that. Again, it depends on the organization. I know, so we have all these individual offices, but we have a lot of meetings, ton of meeting rooms in the office, so we just congregate there. I think we would struggle to stay on the technology side of things completely. Mm-hmm. We'd probably do a blend of the two, and I think that will be common with a lot of other businesses.
Agreed. I think a lot of businesses are going to filter out which employees really do need to be in the office and which employees don't. And at the very least, there's going to be some sort of downsizing. Because if you see that half your employees don't need to be at the office, there's no need for such large space.
There is, and it's happening right now. I know of some developers that there's basically, everyone's hit by this, except for maybe Amazon. So you can either lay off a big chunk of people and keep everyone else, or what you do is lay off maybe a small chunk and then the rest is full-time, part-time, and you have salary reductions based on your position. So I think in that exercise, you start seeing who is really essential, who is not, and then maybe you can cater your office space to only essential people. Back a house, you can work from home, you don't need to be at the office. But again, it's all that accountability.
That makes complete sense. Okay, moving on, I want to ask you, what is Anthem doing right now? Of course, okay, with everything going on, liquidity is very important, which means that there's deals in the market. So is Anthem, and of course, you can only tell me what you can tell me, but is Anthem in a situation where they have enough liquid to start being on the, to attack and be on the offense, or are you guys on the defense?
So there's a couple things here. First of all, Anthem is not just a real estate developer. We own and manage about 5.5 million square feet of commercial space. So when all of this happened, a massive amount of our resources and efforts went towards dealing with our hundreds of tenants. We need to see where they're at. We're trying to collect rent because that's keeping the lights on at the end of the day. We have our own projects that we need to move forward. So big triage and survival with rents. We kept our construction sites open. We were doing sales by appointment only. Now looking at the market and what's out there, you'd expect there to be a lot of opportunities right now, but the difference between this and something like the financial crisis is there's an end in sight here. This is not going to be forever. The financial crisis, who knows? So deals will only come up when someone's underwater or struggling, and I don't think that's coming to the surface yet. You can start seeing it happening with some developers, but it's not, there aren't any fire sales that we're seeing, at least in Canada and Western Canada, yet. I also don't think we've seen the worst of this. Like, we could all go back to work, and we're still going to get the tail whip effect economically. So opportunities like that come about when someone is having liquidity issues, and we're just not there yet. Just because it's short term, and there's a massive, massive amount of help from the federal government, from the banks, from institutions, lenders, all that. So it's kind of preventing those big fire sales that you think would be out there.
Right.
But that's not to say we're not, we're very opportunistic. We're out there, we're talking to lawyers, insolvency groups, accountants, just to see what's out there. So what I think might come out of this is there will be some groups in trouble, no question. There'll be opportunities for a group like Anthem or another very well-known big developer to come in and say, hey, here's our covenant. We can execute on this. We'll take over this problem for me. And this is to either the developer or the lender, be like, hey, we're here. We can execute on the project. Remove the other guy out of the picture. That will happen, but not yet.
You're seeing that in some areas in the tech sector, because you're right. And the difference between what's happening now in terms of the economic downturn is compared to 2008 is the banks are not a part of the problem. They're actually part of the solution.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is what Marcos is saying, by he expects the market will change direction, and why people are a little bit more confident in holding, and why there's not that many fire sales. But the longer this continues, the more they'll people, businesses, development companies will need to liquidate, okay, to keep the lights on. And that provides an opportunity potentially for a hostile takeover, correct? Because we're seeing that in tech companies with tech right now. We're seeing Most companies, especially big ones, are filled with debt. All right, that's what they, how they run. They don't run like, for example, Uber. You know, not saying that Uber is going to be taken over, but what I'm saying is Uber, for example, doesn't make money. They lose money on every ride. And how do they pay employees? How do they expand? They raise capital. So that capital raised is debt. So assuming, you know, other companies which are running on debt, you know, are in a bad position, this gives an opportunity for potential hostile takeover. Is this kind of what I'm hearing from you, that at the moment that's not necessarily the case, but in 2, 3, 4 months down the road, if things seem to get a little bit worse, there may be an opportunity for some serious offense?
Yeah, you nailed it. So maybe not 2, 3, 4 months, but 6 months for sure. I obviously will not say who the developer is, but I know of one for sure. And basically the reason they're in trouble is because they bought some properties in 2016, 2017, where values were here. They're smaller. So 2018, when the values spiked, they refinanced at this price and used that money to go buy other properties. So they're underwater all over the place. Mm-hmm. It's exactly the same thing.
They leverage.
And that, we will see that happen more and more. On the Uber note, I don't know if you saw the article on WeWork that they're now valued at 2 point something billion, down from their previous 50, but that's happening all over.
You know, I'll have a separate podcast on Uber, but it's least favorite companies. You know, in simplicity, and you know this, as an investor and for a development company, when you buy property, when you develop, the whole point is to make money. You're not buying a property and you're not building a building to lose money. So when you have a company like Uber, which is promising investors that we have the best artificial intelligence driving cars, we have this, we have that, just to keep their stock price high so that the executive team can vest at the highest rate possible, they're not actually making money. They're a company that loses money. So I'm glad that you brought that up. Uber is at a lower valuation. They fired recently, I think, 3,000 people. And as they should, that's you know, input and output. That's the output of what's happening.
With development, your costs are, your profit margins are so razor thin. You have to, one of the most important things you'll learn, and you'll hear from any acquisitions person, is you need to buy your land right. If you're paying too much for the land, out of the gate, you're in trouble. So with developers like this that bought here, refinanced to this value, and then started buying more stuff, out of the gate, you're in trouble. So I don't know of many developers that would come in and rescue them at those really, really high valuations. There's definitely not the only group like that, and they will be in trouble.
I mean, I've seen crazier things happen than development companies file for bankruptcy. You know,
it happens. Well, even you could be a massive development company and lose your shirt on one project.
That's the risk. You know, a lot of people don't think about that. When you are a development company, you can't just take shots and shots and shots. Each shot is a significant amount of an investment. And if you miss, good luck.
It's not, yeah, so there's that. And then think about it. You build a tower that you're going to sell, a residential tower. You can't get any money out of that until you're finished the tower and everyone's moved in. You can't take money out of a tower that's half built. So if you've lost money, you're all or nothing on a project like that. You could totally lose your shirt, even as a big, well-established developer. If you miss, you miss.
Exactly. Now, moving on, I want to ask you, I know that Anthem owns property in Alberta. Now, for those of you watching, Alberta is a province in Canada that is strongly correlated to the price of oil, okay? Canada in general, the loonie is strongly correlated to crude oil. When we saw COVID start to come up, we saw the demand in oil drop, which means that the value in the loonie significantly dropped with it, which means that I'm assuming, and I'm gonna look to you for this, real estate prices maybe took a hit in Alberta. People are getting fired left, right, and center. What is Anthem's position in Alberta? What is Anthem going to be doing with the properties that are in the red?
That's a tough one. Alberta right now is kind of this big red circle across most development or investment companies in real estate. It's tough. We've been involved in Alberta for many years, and we will continue to do so. But we have a lot of stuck projects, land that we bought really well at the time, but just as time has gone on, they've been hit so hard with, they're completely oil dependent, especially Calgary, and then everything beneath that services the oil sector. So it's tough. As a really good example, one of our projects we built in Calgary, in one of the best neighborhoods there, our plan was to do these high-end condos, and at the end, we were building spec, which means you build it and then sell it, versus selling it before you built it. Mm-hmm. So as we got to the end of it, we realized we weren't going to be able to hit our numbers on the sales side, so we converted it to rental.
Right.
Because there's a strong rental market there.
Right.
Long term, I don't know what's going to happen in Alberta. They keep getting hit. You think they're coming out of it, and then they get hit by something else, some policy issue, some pipeline issue. It's going to take a lot for Alberta to come out. Calgary and Edmonton are the two markets we're in. Calgary is more white collar, but it also spikes and drops way more. Edmonton seems to be much more kind of steady eddy, trucks along. I think multifamily in those markets will be somewhat consistent. I would be very hard pressed to advise anyone to spend money there, but there are big groups that have made moves in those places. The whole premise of, you know, buy low, sell high, big investment trusts, big institutions have taken gambles there, and they might look like geniuses down the road.
Yeah. Or like we said, miss a shot, potential danger. So question for you as one of the leads in investment at Anthem, with the exchange rate between the US and the Canadian dollar, is Anthem staying away from purchasing in the United States, considering it's essentially a 30% increase?
Not necessarily. We have an office in Sacramento, California. We purchased a land development and house building company in 2014, and one of their offices is in Sacramento. They do primarily, they actually do both land development and house building. And so we were going down there, and we saw the market had really strong fundamentals. And so we looked at urban Sacramento in terms of multifamily rental, but our accounts are relatively split there. So it's not like we're taking Canadian dollars necessarily and putting it and taking a big loss in the US kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then a lot of our partners on those deals are American partners. Mm.
The key there is that you guys have U.S. cash staying in the U.S.
The dollar is not deterring us from investing in the U.S.
Yeah, that was a smart play. So for those of you watching this, sometimes companies will buy, like, for example, Anthem is a Canadian-based company. And for sometimes it's easier to buy a company in a different country to then start working in that country. So, for example, Anthem bought another development company in the US that came with the offices, that came with employees, that came up with the setup and the foundation, which then allows them to have also US bank accounts, hold US cash, have Canadian account, hold Canadian cash, which is why they've kind of been able to manage this situation, which is great. So, Marcos, last question for you, which I'm gonna ask every guest of the show.
Yeah.
Three stocks of your choice. If you have to buy three stocks right now, which stocks are you buying?
So I'll preface this by saying I am not a stock trader by any means. I'd say I'm very much a beginner. So my decisions are based on just what I think makes sense. Mm-hmm. So number one is Air Canada, not because I think it's a well-run company or they're anything special or anything like that. It's for two fundamental reasons. One, we need air travel. Mm-hmm. We'll always need air travel. And number two, it's our national airline. I just can't see it going down. There's no way our government lets that go down, in my mind. I could be wrong.
Yeah. Well, before you move on to number two, I just want to make a point with that. Air Canada is a government-owned airline. If you are going to be investing in an airline, which Marcos is right, eventually people are going to need to travel. People are going to need to fly. That's a part of life, okay? If you are going to invest, you want to invest in a government-owned airline, okay? The reason why is, well, just recently, over the past 2 months, perfect example. A lot of governments right now, countries, are stimulating the economy. They're coming out with stimulus. Who's getting that money? Government-owned airlines. So, for example, Ryanair, right? French-based airline is suing the French government for unfairness. Why? Because the money went to KLM and Air France, government-owned airlines. So it's not necessarily about who provides the best service, who has the best planes. It's who's got the protection. Because we all know that the airline industry is very, very fragile, runs on a ton of debt. And if you are going to invest, you're going to invest in a government-owned airline. So Marcos is correct. Air Canada is government-owned, which is a great buy. Number two.
Yes. Two is Amazon. I wish I bought earlier. I mean, everything took a beating during COVID except for Amazon. It went the total other direction. And it's what we were talking about earlier, supply chains and distribution. So there's this saying that you obviously know in hockey, you do. You don't skate to where the puck is, you skate to where the puck is going to be, and this is very much what that is. It's all going to be on supply chain and distribution going forward and coming out of this.
Awesome. And before you get to number three, let me add something about that. He's absolutely right. I love Amazon. And for those of you who are a part of the Forex Gentleman community, you know that I love Amazon. Not only because of their business, but also because of their leadership. If you look at any, you know, have you watched The Last Dance, the documentary on Michael Jordan?
Oh, yeah.
Other players respect the top of the top, all right? The best, and every NBA player will respect the best. Every hockey player will respect the best. Every soccer player respects the best. Executives, CEOs of other companies respect Bezos. Okay, the executive team, nobody leaves the board, all right? They're vesting the least amount of their shares possible because they believe that the shares in the future will increase, which I believe so as well. Amazon isn't just selling you everything out of the book. Amazon's about to get into healthcare. Amazon's cutting out the middleman by buying their own planes and using their own and starting to ship their own products, okay? Amazon is on the way up and up and up. I don't care what price it's at right now. In the next 3-4 years, you're going to see that move up. So on to number three.
So those first two are just based on my thoughts. And then number three, I'm tying into what I know, which is real estate. I would invest, and I actually will be investing. I'm just waiting for a moment in Canadian REITs. REIT is Real Estate Investment Trust, and there's one in particular I've been eyeing is RioCan. What I like about these REITs is that they invest in Canadian real estate. I think the Canadian markets, MTV, Montreal, Toronto, Vancouver, the fundamentals are just so strong. It's going to continue to be immigration. It's very safe here. It's stable. People like it. So that's not going anywhere. And these REITs are divesting out of secondary markets and into those three primary markets in safe, stable commercial assets. Okay. So that's the third one.
You see, now that is something that he knows more than me about, and I'm going to start doing my research on Canadian REITs because that's really interesting and I do like that point. Marcos, thank you so much for coming, buddy, and we'll see you on the show next week.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Cheers. It's great to have a guy like Marcos as a friend of the show. He's in the trenches. He's in the boardroom with the big boys. He understands what's going on. Anthem Properties right now is in no panic. Banks are not a part of the problem. They're part of the solution. However, 4, 5, 6, 7 months down the road, things may change as liquidity will be more necessary to keep the lights on. But what doesn't change in 4, 5, 6 months down the road? In every business, in every sector, even in our personal lives, are you going to be the same in 6 months from now? Hopefully not. Hopefully you're a little bit better. Hopefully you're a little bit more mature, a little bit more knowledgeable. Adjustment is always necessary. The landscape will always change no matter what. And what happened here with COVID was a forced change, quicker than expected. What companies are going to realize is that it's actually more beneficial to have the employees that can work from home working from home. I don't care. If you're my employee, I don't care if you wake up at 8 a.m. or 8 p.m. If you're getting the tasks at hand done and done with quality, you do you. Thank you for joining me for episode 1 of the David Dotan Show. I'm David Dotan, and what an sugar high. What an sugar high. What an sugar high.